Dr. John is joining us for a segment on avoiding common kitchen accidents. Do we have a shot of Dr. John?
I'm going to spot you.
I know. I'm terrible with knives. Look at you, Dr. John. Look how cute. He goes to law school. He's a doctor. Can you smile for the camera in your best, like, TV doctor? He plays one on TV, I believe.
He's a doctor and a lawyer.
He is.
He's married.
And he's chopping. Are you cutting your... No, he's not cutting his fingers off.
Treat yourself.
Yeah. He's also a really good cook, I understand.
Wow.
Yeah. So he's going to be sharing some heart smart cooking tips. Oh, boy. We are having way too much fun in the kitchen here. Accidents at home, seriously, that involve a trip to the ER often occur in the kitchen. Did you know that? Well, Dr. John Shufeldt, we call him our ER, you know, George Clooney type, is not only going to cover kitchen accidents, he is also cooking up a storm. And Gail, you have not met our fine friend John here, have you? The Mr. Accomplishment.
I shake your hand, but I got a knife. Nice to see you.
Anyway, nice to see you, John.
Thanks.
I mean, you cover it all as an ER doctor, and boy, the last time you were on our show, we were laughing so hard. Not at people, with people. Some of the crazy things that people do. And in the kitchen...
It keeps me entertained.
Yeah, right. Well, in the kitchen, it gets kind of dangerous. You have to really be careful. Watch that chili pepper.
Yeah, that's right. Mm-hmm. Well, the first thing I thought I'd talk about is how to actually cut something, because you can actually cut your finger off, and I cut the tip of my finger off while I was cutting. So one thing I want to go over, I call this the big boy knife, because the first time I used it, I cut my fingernail off. Like cutting a clove of garlic here, for example. If you push it down like this first, and then put your fingertips right on it like this, and just chop very slowly like this. You keep your fingers well away from it. Now, if I'm talking to you, and all of a sudden like this, and have this like finger lay off, that's actually a problem. Now, most kitchen bleeding stops pretty easily with just a little bit of pressure.
Yeah, we got to.
I'm not eating that.
Yeah.
Although, if you dip it in a fabulous pesto sauce,
it's wonderful. So one easy thing to do: you chop your finger a little bit, just put some pressure on it, put a band-aid on it. If you hold it up above your heart, sounds stupid. Squeeze a little, the bleeding will stop.
Really?
If it looks like this, probably need to head to the ER.
Yeah, and bring the finger.
And bring the finger with you.
Yeah, so they can reconnect it.
That's important.
Yeah.
Okay, chopping a jalapeno, for example. How many people have chopped a jalapeno, they put it down, they touch their eye, and all of a sudden, they're walking around, they're tearing like this, and you can't, like, take your eye out and wash it off in the sink. So what you do is run, you know, it's Halloween, it was easy to find.
That's gross.
I'm sorry.
You
actually can't get off my finger.
You've been to Easley's House of Fun.
That's right. Take that away from you.
But one thing you can do is just splash some water in your eye, or just put your eye up to the sink and hold like that and blink quite a bit, and that will actually wash most things out of your eye pretty easily without heading to the ER.
But see, the problem is people panic, and they immediately think, oh my God, I'm bleeding like a sieve, I better run to the
ER. What am I going to do? Exactly.
Yeah.
And so use a little common sense, it's pretty easy. All right, let's talk a little bit about heart smart versus non-heart smart. This is actually the same meal prepared two different ways. This is some homemade linguine pasta here.
Ooh, you're going to burn your fingers.
You have done this. Gail, he's been slaving in the kitchen for an hour.
I know, but here's my thing.
Sweating up a storm.
Whenever I, like, boil spaghetti or whatever or make gravy, I always get burns on my arm.
Right.
What's the best thing to do for that besides, you know, not splashing stuff around? What do you do?
What shouldn't you do? The best thing you shouldn't do is put butter on it. We talked about that last time. If you do get a splatter burn, whether it's actually grease or hot water, if you just run your arm under some cool water, it really cools it down pretty quick. Mm-hmm. All right, so here's a heart smart way and non-heart smart. This is actually cream in here, heavy cream, and this tastes great, as you can imagine with just
delicious.
This.
And it's more filling.
This is a little basil and pesto, basil, pesto, and sun-dried tomato. Sauce I made up a little earlier with a little garlic and pine nuts in it. As you can tell, if you toss this around a little bit, put some cheese in it, it looks very rich.
Let me just do the odor to the TV.
There you go. Yeah. Take a deep breath to you out there because it's really good. And then a little Parmesan cheese, and it's ready to go. You have to mix it up a little more. So that's kind of the non-heart smart way to do it.
Yeah,
so
if you take it looks delicious and it smells good.
Great.
I'm going to eat it the second we're off set. Anyway, the heart smart way to do it is basically the same recipe. Take a little bit of warm water, about half a cup. Put the same ingredients right in the warm water. Let's use my fingers here because I know they're clean.
Of course they are because you're a doctor.
Amen.
Do you use rubber gloves in the kitchen ever?
I actually do use rubber gloves in the kitchen.
Really?
But not with Vaseline. Okay. You pour this over this.
Well, let's talk about the recipe.
Did he just say that?
Yes, he did.
Well, Dr. John, you know what? I think that law school pressure is really getting to those ER deadlines.
It's making my hair gray.
Maybe remind you this is a cooking segment.
Same recipe, no cream, same cheese. You just use a little warm water and a little olive oil, extra virgin olive oil, in place of the cream. And it tastes as good. It's almost as filling, but it's quite a bit more heart healthy than
the cream version.
You know
what? That looks delicious,
Extra virgin olive oil better for you? thin regular olive oil.
You know what? I don't have a clue.
Let me grab a few forks. I want to taste that.
Give it a shot. All right, and then lastly, some new studies have come out that you always hear about using alcohol.
Uh-huh.
And taking an ounce of alcohol, an ounce of ouzo here for my friend Charlie, or some Ravenswood wine. 6 to 8 ounces of red wine, an ounce of alcohol, jump right in.
All right.
Really been showing, nobody can figure out why the French, there's this thing called the French paradox, which I think is two physicians, but it's not. It's how can all these French people drink this wine, eat this food like this,
and
never
healthy.
Die of it? Exactly.
What is the deal
right.
with that?
And they don't like us, but in general, they're healthy.
Right. Well, that's that
which
little
is really
whole
unhealthy.
That historical
right. Politically, it's really
that's
unhealthy.
Right. You know, do they have a short memory or what?
Thank you, darling. That's plenty. That's plenty. Yeah. Okay.
No one can figure out why. And one of the things is that, well, you know, it's all the alcohol. It's all the red wine they drink.
There you go.
And realistically, no one can figure that out yet. And so the American Heart Association just came out with something and said, you know, stick to what you know. And we don't know what the deal with alcohol is yet. And 6 ounces of red wine a night's probably not bad for you, but we can't really tie it to the decrease in heart disease.
Right. And one last question. When in doubt, always trust what my mother says. Everything in moderation, honey. Everything in moderation.
Even butter?
Even butter.
Except on burns.
Except on burns.
Okay.
Anyway, Dr. John, thank you so much. When do you have time for cooking? I mean, come on. Do you have a 24/7 schedule? I mean, he's got children.
I sleep.
A beautiful wife.
I don't sleep much.
You don't? So how many hours a night do you sleep?
I sleep a lot. I mean,
no,
like
you
five
do
or
not.
Six or eight.
No,
eight
you
hours
do?
Of sleep and 2 quarts of water a day, and I'm good to go.
But how do you have time for golf?
Oh,
aren't
God,
you
I don't
a
golf. No,
you
I
don't
golf.
Golf.
You don't golf on Wednesdays?
So,
what's
no,
wrong with you?
Finally, a man who doesn't golf.
It's because, not because I don't like it, because I'm really bad at it.
Really?
Yes.
Goonie golf. You could, you know what? You could be a beer cart lady and go to law school, and you could go ahead and be the ER doctor and own all of those
you know
things
what?
You
it's
own.
It's funny to say, I've always wanted to be, ever since I watched Caddyshack, I've always wanted to be a beer cart lady.
You know what? We might have
Mrs.
to do a
Green.
Show.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think
Dr.
Do it.
John, this is your life.
You know what? He's under pressure. It's okay. Thank you, Dr. John. Thanks. And we got to take a bite
this
of this. You have to take a bite. I have to read.
No, I've tasted this. Mm-hmm. It's wonderful.
Oh, that is good. I love it. You're such a good cook.
Stop. You're killing me.
Oh, honey, please. Welcome back, everyone. Okay, you know you want it. You cannot have it. Quitting smoking, it is so difficult for people to do. And that's why we have Dr. John Shufeldt here in the house. He is here with some great tips on quitting smoking. How are you doing, Dr. John? Good morning.
I'm doing fine. Good morning to
hey,
you.
Did you ever smoke?
I have never smoked.
Thank
I have,
goodness.
For some reason, I've never done anything.
Did you ever try it?
I've never even tried it.
You exciting man, you.
All I do is just eat.
Yeah, so you've never tried smoking?
No, never.
Because I tried it and got sick.
And
I was
never
so
inhaled.
Glad.
Oh, wait, that was somebody else.
That was the president.
Yeah.
Yeah, way back when, something like that. Well, you know, seriously, we were just talking with Eddie a little bit earlier about the fact that smoking is truly the hardest thing to do. It's even harder than, like, drug addiction?
There's a lot of, I mean, smoking is a drug, and people are definitely addicted to the nicotine in smoking. And that's how most of these things, most of the products work. They substitute the nicotine in cigarettes for nicotine in some of the different medication or patches you can take, for example.
So if you quit smoking and you're still chewing the gum, and boy, when people quit smoking, have you noticed, it's the oral fixation there. I mean, they chew that Nicorette to get every last drop out of it.
Oh, so absolutely.
If you continue to do that, you really have not.
Well, it's actually, I mean,
beat the addiction. It's better?
You probably haven't beaten the addiction, but you're not getting all that tar and all the stuff and all the pollutants that you get from smoking, which is really causes a lot of the damage. I mean, I've seen people that are in their 30s in the emergency department come in with smoking-related diseases, you know, from lungs, bronchitis, and heart disease. And some people who do smoke are really at high risk for developing emphysema at a young age. I mean, even in their 30s, you know, you listen to them and say, oh, my God, clearly you smoke. Not only that they smell like an ashtray,
right?
They definitely smoke.
Oh, man. Also, it's amazing with all of the advertising, since you can't do it on TV, but they still say, despite all of the advertising out there to do prevention, that a lot of young people are still the fastest growing group of smokers.
Right.
It's still, what, cool edge now, or it's grunge,
it's
or whatever?
It's 1 in 3 over 18 smoke worldwide.
Wow.
A little less in the United States, 1 in 3 worldwide. 50 million Americans smoke.
Okay, let's talk about what is out there. I've been seeing these new commercials, and of course, I have many dear loved ones and friends who smoke, and I try not to say anything, and other than, you know, they all go outside like this now.
Yeah.
No one smokes inside with all the ashtrays like they did, you know, when I was growing up. My dad smoked, and it's terrible.
They all stand on the porch now and smoke.
No, they do.
They're porch
it's
smokers.
Patio time.
Right.
But there's a lot of new stuff out there, and I don't know what's good, what's not good, so
well,
run it down for us.
I mean, there's all the nicotine-based substitutes. There's nicotine gum, which is Nicorette gum, which you can see people, you know, chomping on a mile a minute. There's nicotine patches that you don't need prescriptions for.
Wait a minute. On the nicotine patches, too, you can't smoke when you're on a patch, or you can pass out. Isn't that dangerous if you combine it?
No, you can't hold your breath and put no. You can.
No,
you put a bag over your head.
No, my friend said if you smoke and you have a patch on, like you can die.
Well, you definitely double the dose of nicotine you're getting. You're getting the nicotine in the cigarette, but also the nicotine in the patch, which can be up to 24 milligrams of nicotine, which is now it's over 24 hours, but it's a relatively high dose of nicotine.
Yeah, so you won't pass out.
I don't think you're going to pass out from it, but you'll definitely get a nice buzz because, I mean, you have all this nicotine going on in your body.
Right.
So there's a patch, there's gum. There's nicotine. While I was at Eckerd's Pharmacy last night buying all this stuff.
And it's expensive, you were saying.
Yeah, it's not cheap. And there's nicotine water out there as well.
Nicotine water?
Yeah, Nico water.
You know, what is up with us? We have to have the bottled water, and now we have to have nicotine water.
There's actually now nicotine nasal spray, and there's nicotine inhaler that looks like a little cigarette. That you need a prescription for.
Wait a minute. You're still getting the hit. You're still not solving the bigger problem, are you?
Well, yeah. You're still addicted to nicotine, but you don't get all the things that cause lung cancer, heart disease, for example.
Oh.
And that's kind of the upside. There's also a medication called Zyban, which is Wellbutrin. It's an antidepressant. If you use a nicotine substitute, you'll double your chances of quitting smoking.
Mm-hmm.
If you use the Zyban or Wellbutrin, you'll also double your chances of quitting smoking.
And how does that work? Because it's an antidepressant, and yet I've heard it almost like goes to the brain and like turns off that urge.
It stops the irritability that you get from nicotine withdrawal. It stops the restlessness that people get. You see people who quit smoking, and not only are they have an oral fixation, and they're eating everything in sight, you know, the fake apples on the table, but they're also very irritable and very anxious. And
oh,
it kind
yes.
of blunts that effect.
Yeah, well, and the other thing, too, a lot of women who smoke, okay, say, I don't want to quit smoking because I'll get fat, I'll gain weight, I'll gain 30 pounds. Is that really true?
I think people substitute one oral fixation for the other. And the Wellbutrin definitely curbs some of that. But when you go off it, you definitely have a higher chance of increasing. So, you know, we tell people in the little bit of information I give them in the ER about quitting smoking, they've got to really start exercising. They've got to do some sort of cardiovascular aerobic activity.
On a serious note, I think it's really important to kind of run down how bad smoking is for you. And truly, you know, my father was a smoker. He was 48, died of a heart attack, and he had quit like a year before. But that's really been sort of a mantra for me. You know, this is serious, serious stuff you're talking about.
Yeah, 500,000 people a year die from smoking-related illnesses. And, yes, younger and younger and younger.
And women, too. You know, we've always done cardiovascular disease, associating it with men, and yet in recent years there's been a lot more advertising. You know, women are really impacted as well.
And I can tell you it's a horrible death. The people who die from smoking-related illness from their lungs, it is an absolutely horrible death. They are short of breath 24 hours a day.
Yeah. Wow. That's just frightening. What about chew? Because a lot of people here in Arizona do the whole tobacco chewing.
Definitely have an increased risk of head and neck cancer, lip cancer, for example. A lot of these medications have not been proven to work for people who just chew, use smokeless tobacco. They definitely work for the smoking. Theoretically, they should work because of the nicotine in the chew. But people who chew definitely have a high risk of head and neck cancer. And so you see people get half their jaw removed, their lips and their soft palate removed.
I saw this presentation, one of those pictures. That'll make you quit right there.
Young
people. So how does it change? Because now with all of the laws out there, you know, no smoking anywhere. And again, I do kind of feel sorry for the smokers because they're all sort of corralled into, you know, the crummy background.
Yeah.
It is.
Yeah.
It is. You know, you're sequestered to the patio. I mean, when my sister smoked, she would stick her head out. I said, you can smoke just right here. And she says, no. And she was like, off on the patio. We were trying to have a conversation in the living room. It just didn't work.
Yeah.
You know, truly.
The other things that people do are hypnosis, acupuncture, mental imagery. Those things have really never been proven on a larger study to increase your risk. Probably not bad to do, but not the be-all and end-all.
Wow.
People believe kind of the medication, Zyban, works, Wellbutrin, and then also the substitution of the nicotine.
And also, what about cold turkey, finally? Cold turkey, that's it? Ding.
Well, that's how you're supposed to. You're supposed to pick a day, and even if you decrease up until that day, you're supposed to pick a day and stop. In the meantime, throw your cigarettes out, throw your ashtrays out.
And don't have a social life. Don't talk to your children, your spouse, or anybody for about 2 months, because you are the biggest crab on the planet. You feel crabby, right?
Right.
I mean, it's just you're so irritable.
And that's why I think the Wellbutrin helps.
Yeah. Okay. Let's see here. Yeah. Wellbutrin, we got this, and you have your receipt to take this all back, because you don't smoke. That's, what, $100 here or something?
I'm ready to quit right now.
Okay. Dr. John, stick around a little bit. As you know, he's head of ER in St. Joseph's Hospital. We're going to talk about some new trends in medicine.
Right.
Some good information. It's sort of our healthy living day today. Can I drink coffee? Is that real bad?
No, but I'll substitute it with Diet Coke.
Oh, yeah. NutraSweet. There's a healthy kick. Okay.
I can't remember.